Welcome to another episode of The Nozzle, where I bring you the most up-to-date news on upcoming game titles and releases. This episode is a special one, because, you know, I don't typically release two nozzles within the same week. However, with the hype of EverQuest Next, and the fact that this game I'm about to discuss doesn't have much longer on Kickstarter, I wanted to get this out as soon as possible. Today, I'm going to be talking about 7 Days to Die, an open-world, voxel-based sandbox game which takes the elements of FPS, survival horror, and RPG games. To me, this game is a marriage of DayZ and Minecraft. I know a lot of people compare games nowadays to Minecraft and even DayZ, but honestly, this one actually deserves it. The story of this game is in the year 2034, where nuclear attacks have decimated the Earth, and the remaining population is infected by an unknown virus. Those unfortunate enough to not be taken out by the blast have only 7 days after infection before they become the zombies that once hunted them. Now, this story is far from original. In fact, it's a little bit more than bland. However, this game is a sandbox. The player is responsible for creating their own story if they want to ignore the main storyline of the game. Talking about story, the developers of 7 Days to Die is stating that their main story mode will offer a dynamic story generation system which puts the player in charge of the story solving by leaving survivor notes along their path. These survivor notes can lead them to unique rewards and potentially a cure to the infection. One of the most interesting gameplay designs of 7 Days to Die is the fully destructible, voxel-based world. If you see it, it can be blown sky high. If you don't want to just destroy your world, you can always build within their deep crafting system. Either way, the world is your oyster. As you progress through the story, you will earn experience through your actions. You can upgrade your skills in melee, guns, crafting, stealth, and more. Being a longtime veteran of RPGs and MMOs, I can tell you right now, this callback to classic RPGs is more than enticing in a game like this. 7 Days to Die will also be offering multiple game modes, including a creative mode a la Minecraft, and co-op multiplayer functionality so you can play with your friends. I have yet to see any multiplayer gameplay myself, but I'm sure the ability to play traditional tower defense or generic survival mode will pique the curiosity of more than just myself. Overall, 7 Days to Die is looking to be a game I will be spending hours of my time playing. I think the developers have done a fantastic job of blending different game elements together from the titles we've come to know as the staples of their genre. Now, here's the reason why I posted this episode of The Nozzle so early. Currently, 7 Days to Die has 9 days left on Kickstarter, depending on what country you hail from. Their goal of $200,000 is almost there, with a total of 5,465 backers who have pledged over $187,000. Obviously, the community is excited for the game, and I have no doubts they will reach their goal by August 15th. If you are interested in pledging and gaining access to early alpha or beta, depending on how much you pay, head to the link on the screen. As a freebie, I received an email today stating that by, ignoring potential mail server issues, account registration and client download for early alpha will be available by August 16th. That's a day after their 200,000 pledge goal. If you would like early alpha over beta access, you must pledge $35 or more. Well, I hope you guys enjoy this episode of The Nozzle. As always, this is Byronic, and that is it.